everybody, and welcome. In today's video, I thought I'd do a Q&A because mid-August this channel hit 10,000 subscribers, and I figured there's probably a lot of new people here, and so just in case you'd like to get to know me, I thought this would be interesting for you because I know that this is the sort of content that interests me with my favorite content creators. So I received a bunch of your questions from the last video that I posted on YouTube and also on Instagram, and I received a lot of questions, so I've sort of compiled some of them here because a lot of them repeated the same themes. So if I don't get to exactly your question, it might be because I've compiled it with someone else's because they were very similar. Or if I don't get to it at all, don't hesitate to leave it in the comments below this video and maybe I can get back to you in more detail there. But yeah, let's get started. I also have some cinnamon tea here to drink and keep warm while I'm speaking to you. This is probably going to be a lengthier video than usual, so don't hesitate to grab a drink of your choice. And maybe some sewing and knitting as well. I have a knitting project at the moment. Usually I do sewing chats for these Q&A videos, but I don't have any hand sewing at hand at the moment. And so I'm working on the Kip sweater by Rebecca Klo in this Ulysse yarn from Rerum Natura. If you saw my last video, you know that I ordered the wrong yarn, but this is the right yarn that I wanted to use. This is the Poivre blanc, or white pepper colorway that I wanted to use, and I've just finished doing the back panel piece and now I'm working on the shoulders. Although I'm not entirely sure how good I'm going to be at knitting and speaking at the same time, so I'll try, but it might not be very successful. In case this is the very first video that you're clicking on, I'll introduce myself a little bit. My name is Sarah, welcome. On this channel, I talk mostly about the creative process of my sewing projects, but a little bit of knitting and a little bit of embroidery now that I dabble in from time to time, and then a little bit of my private life as well, just in case that inspires you too. And I'm also originally from New England in the United States, but I moved to France back in 2009, so I've been here for about 15 years. I live and work here, I'm a dual citizen now. I live in the suburbs of Paris and I work in Paris, and so sometimes my content is sort of a mix of American French culture, so perhaps it's interesting to you too. Today we're filming in a different location. It's because I'm filming in the morning. I have something planned this afternoon, and my sewing corner is on the ground floor of this two-floor sort of house apartment. We share walls with our neighbors, so it's not exactly a house. And especially in the fall and winter, the ground floor gets no sun, no natural daylight until about 2 PM, and I have plans. So we're filming in my bedroom on the second floor today. I really love this blue wall. The old owners of this house actually painted this wall, so I'm not entirely sure what color it is, but I love it. And so yeah, welcome to my second floor with a lot more natural lighting. So I've separated these questions into about two categories. The first is kind of sewing and knitting, advice, how I started sewing, etc. And then the second part I grouped all of the more personal questions or YouTube questions. So the first question is sort of a compilation of a few different questions. It's when and how did you learn to sew? Was it encouraged at your childhood home? How long have you known how to knit and sew? And who taught you these skills? So my very first memory of sewing was actually with my grandmother on my father's side. I was visiting her house for the weekend, I think. And I'm a child of the 90s, and so I lived the Beanie Baby craze, and I was showing her my favorite Beanie Baby, which was the lamb, I think. Yeah. And she, I think the conversation went something like, she asked me, how come they don't have any clothes? and then she proposed to show me how to make clothes for my Beanie Baby. And so she went up to the attic where she kept her sewing supplies, and she brought down her sewing basket. And I remember that specifically because she would dry herbs and flowers in her attic, and I remember the fabric smelled like dried herbs and flowers. And she pulled out some squares of leftover cotton fabric. I think that they were actually Liberty fabrics, I'm not entirely sure, but they were sort of ditzy flowery fabrics. And she showed me, she folded it in half, it was sort of a square rectangle shape, and she cut out in the fold a neckline, sort of a half circle for the neckline, and then almost like a kimono shape, but not exactly, with the rest of the fabric, and then showed me how to sew it right sides together by hand with just a running stitch. And then I was off. Ooh, and then also, she had the idea of using a little scrap piece of ribbon to tie it around the waist to kind of gather it up so that it fit the Beanie Baby a little bit well, which is the very first time I made a waisted garment, which is a theme in my makes and how I like to wear my clothes if you watch this channel a little bit. And so yeah, I became a little bit obsessed with making clothes for my Beanie Babies. Just that dress, not any other kind of clothes. And I would take my savings, my teeny tiny savings that I had from dog and cat sitting around my neighborhood, to Joanne's Fabrics to buy their fat quarters. And I remember once I was very ambitious, I bought a piece of velvet, and my neighbor was talking to me about nap, and I had absolutely no idea what she was talking about. I don't think that went very well. But I didn't actually start making clothes After I stopped playing with Beanie Babies, I kind of stopped sewing as well. And I didn't really knit. I remember my best friend, started learning how to knit a scarf, just not even stockinette, just knitting, no purling, all the way, like each row, every time. And we were working on squares for years. And it never amounted very much, but I remember enjoying that too. But yeah, I never finished a knitting thing until I was an adult, sort of later in life. But I started sewing garments when I was about 27, I think, when I had my first full-time job. Immigrating to France meant that I was on a lot of temporary contracts and then studying with a very small budget. So I didn't really have the budget or time or space to sort of invest in that kind of hobby. And so once I had my first, it's not a permanent contract, it's, what is it called? It's a CDD versus a CDI. In French, it means a contract with a already determined length of time versus a contract with an indeterminate length of time. And the indeterminate length is when you have sort of a full-time position in a company where you can sort of invest your time and you get full-time benefits, etc. And so getting a full-time permanent job was very hard for me as an immigrant, because that meant that my company had to sponsor me, which is very expensive, and they have to prove that there are no French or European people qualified for the job, and they have to justify that. So that's why I did my master's and specialized to be able to get a job in France, and that's also how I stayed in France and eventually became a citizen. I was not married or civil union to my partner at the time. And so maybe I'll get into that immigration story another time in more detail. But basically, once I had that job, I had the space and time to invest in my home, put down roots, and invest in a hobby. So buy a sewing machine, because before I was kind of keeping my things down to two suitcases, because every time a contract ended, I had to go back to the US. And so yeah, around 27 was when I bought my sewing machine. And I started sewing, I think my first sewing project was in a cotton and Swiss dotted cotton lawn, and I made the Colette, or Seamwork now, Sorbetto top, which is still a free pattern that you can find online. I'll link it below. And I remember feeling it was so cool to finally learn how to use a machine, because that's something that I always wanted to learn how to do, and create something 3D that fit me out of something flat. That was just so cool to me. Although I remember cutting fabric was really, really freaky for me for a little while. And I didn't end up actually keeping it or using it very much, because it turned out to be very transparent and a little bit tight around the arm side. But yeah, I was very proud of that. And that's how I started sewing. Knitting I started much later. Apart from that square I knitted for hours and hours during my youth, I wanted something that I could bring to the couch, so something that I could relax with, because sewing is sometimes very physical. You know, you're up and down ironing and sewing and putting pieces together, and it's not very portable. It's not something that I can relax and really watch a series with, and so I've been really enjoying it, and I'm excited to see where that goes. The next question is, what motivated you to start making your clothes? And there are a few different reasons why. The first is quality. So I had a very small budget for clothes. Even now, I don't invest a whole lot in ready-to-wear clothes. I wanted to be able to use quality fibers, such as wool, for example, which can be very expensive in ready-to-wear. And I wanted to have quality finishings, so control the quality of the insides and, yeah, the way it's made. And then also fit. I have a body that doesn't always fit into industry standards. I have a very small rib cage, for example, so ready-to-wear bras, the bra bands are usually one size too big on me, or my waist is about two sizes smaller than my hips. And so I ended up wearing mostly stretchy tops that would fit the top half of my body, and then even stretchy bottoms because it was very hard to find jeans or pants in general or dresses that fit my top and bottom half, or my waist and my hips, and so that was very frustrating. And then the third reason is also having the choice of what kind of style and color and cut of my clothes that are independent from trends. Current trends is something, you know, you get used to having so much control that it's really hard to then go looking for what you want in stores and find it. So I like having that control. If I want to make something that's retro or vintage, I can. If I want to make something super modern, I can. Yeah, it's a certain amount of control and power that you have once you start making your own clothes. And then the last reason is crafting. I love working with my hands, especially because my work consists of sitting at a desk behind a computer staring at a screen all day. And so it's nice to be able to come home and work with fibers and fabrics and with my hands and not stare at a screen some more. And it feels very satisfying. It's a hobby that I really like to do. I'm not actually sure if I'll get any knitting done. This is pretty complicated, speaking to the camera and doing something else at the same time. I'm not even drinking my tea. But the third question is, do you make one project at a time, or do you have multiple projects going at the same time? And I'm pretty good about making one project at a time. If I do two projects, it's because I want to kind of vary the sewing levels. So sometimes I'll be working on something really hard and complicated that takes a lot of time, and I want something quick to sort of boost my sewing motivation, something that's really easy to sew and quick. And I like being able to juggle between those two, but usually I have just one at a time because I know that I get very easily overwhelmed when there are too many things in my to sew pile. And then I don't have a whole lot of space for those ongoing projects to stock them because my sewing corner that you see in my videos is the only space I have. I do have space in the attic and underneath this bed in drawers for my fabric, but yeah, I don't have a whole lot of space for my ongoing projects. But then at the same time, I usually have a knitting project going one at a time, or an embroidery project, and so I have sort of, yeah, I can change it up a little bit when I get tired of sewing and I want to relax a little bit. And that really helps me keep up my motivation to keep sewing and not get burnt out and sort of put it aside for months at a time. The next question is, have you ever sewn or knitted anything for your husband? I haven't knitted anything yet, but maybe that could be an option. But I have made an apron for my husband, for example. This is a subject of contention between us. Not high conflict, but men's fashion doesn't really interest me. I don't pay very much attention, and then I don't know how to fit a masculine body. I haven't learned that, and I find the resources very difficult to find. For example, I once tried to make him the Thread Theory Fairfield button-down shirt, that's the name of it, but it was incredibly hard. He was between three different sizes, and I didn't know which one to pick or how to modify the pattern so that it would fit him in all three parts of his body. And I sewed up a mock-up, and it took me hours. A button-down shirt mock-up is not much further from a finished button-down shirt. And it ended up not being able to button at the collar at all. It didn't fit his neck. And I just felt so discouraged. I spent hours researching how to modify men's garments so that they fit better, and it's just opaque. Maybe there are more resources now. I think that that was about 6-7 years ago, so I might be able to, but he doesn't wear button-down shirts. He wears it maybe to weddings or special occasions once or twice a year, and with body fluctuations, who knows if it would fit him from 1 year to another. So he's more of a t-shirt and jeans sort of person. So I just don't, there's not really anything, but I did make him an apron. So in the way that we divide up the tasks in this house, I handle all the cleaning and he handles all the cooking, which suits me because I'm very bad and impatient at cooking. So I made him the Sam apron from Helen's Closet in a Bordeaux cotton twill, I think it was. And I wanted something in a darker color as well because he's very good at making things like stews. So in the north of France, they have cabanade, which he's very good at. It's very good. It's like bœuf bourguignon, but instead of wine, it's with beer and gingerbread and brown sugar, and it's, oh, so good. Or he makes a really good bolognese sauce, or he makes really good buttered chicken. It's, oh. But those stain, and that's why I wanted a darker fabric. He didn't want his picture on social media, so I will put a top-down photo here, but I don't have a photo of it on him, which is fine. I respect his decision not to be on social media. But yeah, now that I'm knitting, I think because he likes wearing stretchy tops, like t-shirts in the summertime and sweaters in the wintertime, maybe I can make him a sweater now, although that would be a big project. And I think he'd have to figure out how to communicate exactly the style he wanted. I don't think he pays much attention either in the color he wants before I invest hours and maybe months into making a sweater. So we'll see. We'll see. Another question I got was, what is your experience with natural fibers? Is this something you would consider for future fabrics? And I love working with natural fibers. Wool, cotton, linen, silk, oh, even viscose, even though that's a highly manufactured fiber. I love it. They're easier to work with, I find. They have a little bit more bounce and give to them than polyester fabrics. They're easier to shape with steam and with heat, with an iron. And they don't go shiny like polyester fabrics do. And then just in general for wearing them, they're much more breathable and soft against the skin and just much more agreeable. And that's one of the great things about sewing. You can choose what kind of fibers are against your skin. And yeah, I love working with natural fibers. I highly recommend them. Another question was, where do you usually get your fashion inspiration? Online, just seeing the fashion in Paris. And that's a great question. I do get a lot of fashion inspiration in Paris. I work in the center of Paris, sort of near to the Luxembourg Garden and the Notre Dame, sort of in between the Saint-Germain-des-Prés neighborhood, which is sort of old traditional style, old money sort of sophistication, and then the Sorbonne, which is the Paris one of the Paris universities. So there are lots of students as well, and younger student style, and so I like that sort of mix. That's also where you find a lot of cinemas and bookstores, and so it's sort of an intellectual vibe where I work. And yeah, I like seeing what people are wearing, and then there's also the terrace culture of sitting at a cafe on a terrace and watching people go by, which is a very French thing to do. And I definitely like engaging in that activity and watching people and looking at what they're wearing, sort of subtly, you know, I'm not like staring at them. But I also find a lot of inspiration on Instagram especially. I spend too much time on Instagram. but I like Instagram because I like seeing what people are sewing and how they're styling their clothes, and it's not so much ready to wear, it's more patterns that I can find to make myself too. And then it's much more realistic bodies, and I find budgets and lifestyles are closer to my own, and so much more relatable content I find, and so that's where I get a lot of my ideas. But I have also recently been watching and looking at more content from fashion influencers who wear ready-to-wear clothes, just because I'm looking for ideas for color association or for perhaps different silhouettes. But I do like to try and dose that, sort of control how much of that I'm watching and looking at, because typically I don't relate as much to the fashion influencers in body type or lifestyle or budget. A lot of them are promoting very expensive clothes and a very expensive lifestyle, such as travel or special events, and have access to a much more privileged lifestyle. And so sometimes I find myself even subconsciously getting into this sort of comparison game where I start feeling bad about myself and my lifestyle and the things I can afford. and so, yeah, I try and limit how much I look at that. Another question was, any lifetime achievement in projects on the horizon? No. And I'm really happy about that. My wedding dress was a huge project. I'm sewing for everyday life. Nothing big or huge coming up in my life at the moment, so yeah, it's much more relaxed, and I'm happy with that. Another question was a few different questions that I sort of put together, and it was, how do you find fabric or select fabric and figure out weight for a certain project? That is very tricky, and that's why I like to do these videos where I show you my plans every season and the fabrics that I'm going to be matching with different patterns. That's how I learned, is watching other content creators do the same thing, especially the old Sew Over It videos with Lizzie Comfort and how she used to do that. That really, really helped me. Or what you can do is pay close attention to the fabric recommended for the pattern. Pattern makers always recommend the kind of fabric, perhaps not weight, but the type of fabric that's the best for that pattern. And sometimes they even indicate what fabric they used for the sample photos of the pattern. And so you can go and find that fabric exactly and make it up when you're absolutely unsure. Otherwise, I highly recommend when you're starting out shopping for fabric in person, because then you can go and feel the fabric and feel the weight of it and compare it to perhaps your ready-to-wear clothes that you have in a similar weight in the same garment. And then yeah, it comes sort of from experience. Sometimes you might find that fabrics that are printed for sewing are a little bit more quilting weight. I find that getting into dead stock fabrics or finding somewhere that sells dead stock fabrics, so leftover fabrics from fashion collections or ready-to-wear lines, and so they are garment weight and they were used for different kinds of garments. You perhaps don't know which garments they were used for, but you can kind of get a feel of it. It's a lot more sort of mixes of fibers and weights that are a lot more interesting, I find. So hopefully you have that available to you. And otherwise, try and find other content creators on Instagram or YouTube who are showing you exactly what kind of fabric they made a certain pattern out of. I like when I find a pattern I want to make, I look at the hashtag and I look at what other people are making. And I, for example, in my Instagram posts, always put what fabric I use, so that if you're looking to make the same exact thing or try making it in a different color but the same weight of fabric, you can find that. So a lot of content creators do that, so check that out too. And then the last question I got from the sewing or knitting part of this Q&A was beginner knitting pattern recommendations. I'm also a beginner knitter, so I don't have a whole lot of experience, but I did recently make the Tolstati by Rebecca Clough of the Crayabea, and that was pretty easy to make. It's pretty simple, and the instructions were pretty good, and you can find videos of the techniques that are used as well to help you out, and I think that would be a pretty encouraging project to try for the first time. Otherwise, if you're looking to make more of a sweater for the cooler season, my very first pattern that I tried and that turned out pretty well is the Ladies Classic Raglan Pullover by Jane Richmond. It's a pretty simple raglan sweater, and I like that it's long and it's got waist shaping as well, so you learn how to do increases and decreases, a raglan sleeve, ribbing. It was pretty nice to knit up, and I recommend that one as well. So now we get to the personal questions, so I will sit back a little bit. And the first question is, what is my job? So I work in publishing. My first love, if you don't know, is not actually sewing, it's reading, it's books. I have been a bookworm since I first started learning to read. That was a magical moment in my life, and I read a lot. But I don't work in literature, I work in nonfiction illustrated books. So books like self-help or artisanal crafts like woodworking or yoga or how to sew or how to draw and those kind of books. And I work for a French publishing house, and I specifically handle the foreign rights for my company. I do it by myself, so I'm the manager, but I don't manage anybody else. And my job consists of finding foreign publishers to translate our books into their languages, and then I negotiate the contract, which means that I often travel for work. I travel to international book fairs to meet with foreign publishers and show them our books, and do sort of commercial pitches of our books in English. That way I get to use my English as well, because otherwise at the publishing house, because it's a French publishing house, I speak French. All my colleagues are French and I speak French there. And so, for example, if you know the book Harry Potter was published by the English publisher Bloomsbury, and it exists in languages all over the world. So the edition that was published in French is by Gallimard. And so someone like me found Gallimard, proposed the book, and then negotiated the contract, and now Gallimard pays a royalty back to Bloomsbury for every copy that they sell, probably. I don't know that contract. I don't work there. but that's how it works, my job, and I love it. A lot of people think that perhaps I should focus only on sewing and make a business out of my sewing or with this YouTube channel, but honestly, I absolutely love my job. I love working in books, and I don't think that I could give it up. It's a big part of my personality and what I'm interested in, and so yeah, I think balancing the two is working for me for now. Second question is, how old are you? And this is something that I haven't actually shared yet on this channel or on my Instagram. I'm 36 years old, I turned 36 in July, and I think that I was worried about sharing this because I worry about the timeline that is socially sort of pressed on women, especially, not just marriage and babies, but also where you are in your job, if you own where you live, what kind of lifestyle you have, if you have a certain kind of disposable income. Yeah, I think there's a lot of pressure, especially on women. And I was afraid that people in the community would sort of impose those pressures on me and start asking much more personal sort of leading questions about my life, like, why haven't you done this yet? Or how come you don't do this? but I've decided to trust you. I'm starting to get to know you from the comments, the very kind comments that you leave on this channel. And so I figured, you know what? Even if someone does try and pressure me to do something I'm not comfortable with, or get more information that I'm not comfortable sharing with, I'm getting more comfortable with not feeling like I have to respond or feeling like I have to explain myself. So that's one thing. Also, I think that a lot of the pressure is internalized, and I put pressure on myself all by myself. And yeah, so I am 36. I was born in 1988. I graduated high school in 2006. And there you go. Another question was, how long have you been training ballet? And I started ballet when I was 5 until I was about 10. I was able to participate in the Nutcracker performances 2 years in a row at the Hartford Bushnell Theater, because I'm originally from West Hartford, Connecticut. And then I stopped, mostly because it was too much, 3 times a week for my parents. Especially, it's a very expensive sport for kids, And then I was also told that I had weak ankles and I couldn't do point work, so I lost interest immediately. I started doing it again when I was about 29, 30, because in Paris there are a lot of adult ballet classes that you can choose from. A lot of them are more intermediate level because a lot of French girls especially do ballet throughout their adolescence, like throughout their childhood, and so they have a basic knowledge of ballet. They don't have to start over again. But I got really into it in 2018, 2019, and throughout the pandemic as well. But then I started having really bad hip problems, and it's not quite resolved, but by the time I figured it out a little bit, I had gotten completely out of shape. We had moved to the suburbs of Paris. Now it takes me about 45 minutes to get to and from my classes each way. The classes are an hour and a half long, and it's just no longer very realistic for my lifestyle anymore to do it at least three times a week, an hour and a half class. And I miss it. I miss it a lot. I want to get back into it somehow and figure out a way to incorporate it into my lifestyle now. And it's just frustrating. There aren't any beginner classes in my area, so we'll see. Maybe online. I did find a ballet Pilates class that combines ballet and Pilates techniques that I love. It's not dancing or bar work, which I really, really miss. I love working at the bar and dancing to music. Yeah, I'd like to get back into that. So the next question is kind of a long one. It's, at least for me, it's why live in France? And what is the difference between living in France and the US? many reasons. So I can't really compare life in the US to life in France because I moved here, or I came here for the first time and started living here more than I was living in the US when I was 21 years old. So I've never been a young professional in the US. I've always been either growing up or a student. I left during my undergraduate degree at UConn. And so the reasons I live in France is first for the language. I love French. I love speaking French. I love hearing it. I find it a fascinating language. And it's really hard to get into why I chose to live in France versus the US, because I imagine that it's different in different parts of the US, so it's hard to compare, but I do know that based on my experience growing up and my experience here in France, which are very specific to me, I know that there are a lot of parts of French culture that really appeal to me, such as set mealtimes, access to fresh fruits and veggies, access to affordable healthcare and education, for example, are big ones. I was able to do my master's here without taking out student loans, and I was able to do it while working in a publishing company as an apprentice, and they paid for my master's degree, which cost them not more than 10,000 euros, I think more like 5,000. So that's just unheard of in the US. or definitely access to healthcare. For example, my hip problem, I didn't go into debt figuring that out. I won't go into too much detail because I don't want to become too critical or political about the US. There are downsides to living in France, of course. No place is perfect, but I do prefer my life here. And if you do have more specific questions about life in France, don't hesitate to leave them in the comments below. I'd be happy to share. Another question that was really interesting is, do people really dress like Emily in Paris in Paris? no. I've only watched a few episodes of the first season because I think that series is fun, but a little bit too silly for me. And also I think that because I live here and I know French and American culture pretty well now, I find it kind of cliche and exaggerated, which is fine. It's a fun series. And if you've never lived in France, it's probably really interesting and cool to see. And especially the colors and the setting and the costumes are really lovely, like really beautiful to look at. So I understand if you like it. I just don't really. I think that because I am both French and American, I find cliches and stereotypes just tired. I have very little patience for stereotypes, for example, about American culture, about Americans being uncultured or unsophisticated or lazy. It's just okay. Or French people being super skinny and always fashionable and polyamorous and having cigarettes for lunch, like, no. So I have very little patience for that, and I find that the series uses those a lot. But it's kind of strange because it seems like the cliches that they present are kind of old, as in it sort of feels like it's based on an experience of someone who came to work in France in the late 90s or early 2000s and sort of transposed that experience on a modern girl with social media. It's very strange because a lot of the things that they're presenting are just not. French people aren't all casually adulterers, for example. That's not a thing. maybe in very specific social circles, but I don't know them and I've never met them. So that's just one example. Anyway, to get back to the fashion question, so do people dress like Emily in Paris? No, but they can if they want to. It's kind of like, do people dress like Carrie in Sex and the City in New York? No, but they can. Like, I think that the thing about living in a big city, which is true for many big cities, is that there's a lot of room for creative expression. And so if someone were to walk down the street in something that Emily wears in the series, like, people might stare or look at her, but they won't, like, yell insults across the street or make fun of her to her face, you know, things like that. She won't get harassed for it, I think. I've never really had such a loud fashion sense, but yeah, you can. And then it depends on the neighborhood in Paris too. There are different neighborhoods where it's more casual or it's very dressed up, or, you know, you can find that ambiance here or the event. And then it's hard to say what people wear exactly in Paris because the styles are so diverse, and especially with the internet and different trends online, it's a little bit more universal, the trends now. And then I see, for example, tourists who come to the city and they dress up in their bows and berets and they walk around and they have their quintessential Parisian experience, which is fine too, it's fun to see. And then I also see, for example, during Paris Fashion Weeks, people wear all kinds of wacky outfits and it's fun. And so yeah, I think that the city is a city where you can experiment with style and it's fine. I like that about Paris. What I can say about Paris fashion that you'll see a lot more here than you will in other cities is that you will find a lot more natural colors and neutral colors like navy blue, brown, gray, beige, and it's a lot more timeless pieces that you can wear over and over again versus trendy pieces, and then understated elegance. And not everybody, but you will kind of get the feeling for that when you're walking around Paris. And I like that too. It corresponds to my fashion sense a little bit more. And so I do feel like that I fit in a little bit more here. And if I want to experiment with something that's not particularly trendy, then I can do that too. And but yeah, there are no rules to fashion, to coming and visiting Paris, to what you wear in Paris. Wear what makes you happy. And then another question is, do you have sewing friends in Paris? And yes, I do. I know one or two people who sew here, and we don't see each other very often, but when we do, it's really interesting because we can go into detail on our projects and things, and it kind of establishes such commonalities that it feels like we already know each other, even if we don't see each other very often, close to them. Like, I can ask questions about social media, like, I saw this, and what do you think about it? Or, what about this pattern that I found, I want to make it in this color, what do you think? It's really cool, and I highly encourage finding sewing friends yourself if you can. The last question I have about living in France is, what is your favorite French town or city and why? And that is a very hard question. France is a beautiful country and it has so many different regions, just in terms of architecture and natural landscape. It's gorgeous, and there are so many different kinds. And I've only ever lived in Paris and Lille, which is in the northeast part of France. And so I can't tell you which one is the best. I haven't lived in all of them. And I imagine that you can have a fabulous experience in many French cities. But based on my experience, I decided to live in Paris because I wanted to work in publishing, and most of the publishing houses are based in Paris. But also, compared to my life in Lille, I find that there are more people like me in Paris, and I appreciate that. So, for example, people who have lived abroad, or people who come from abroad and who have integrated life in France. And compared to Lille, for example, which isn't a bad thing, but it can be kind of tiring, is that in Lille I'm seen as foreign, and it's something, I'm seen as like Sarah the American versus just Sarah, whereas in Paris I'm just Sarah. It's not exceptional that I come from another culture, that I speak more than one language here. Paris is multicultural and diverse and I love it, and I feel like I fit in much better here. Nobody asks me in the first 5 minutes of meeting me when I'm going home, for example. And so yeah, I would say Paris. And then the very last question that I got that I'll cover today is, what is your most viewed video? And wondering if your new wedding dress series drew lots of new viewers. So the wedding dress series did interest a lot of people, which is great, but I think it's such a niche topic and such a specific project that it only really interests people who are interested in making a wedding dress of their own or for someone else. And so they've done well, but not particularly well. The videos that do well are the introductory to sewing, so sort of getting into sewing, free patterns or sewing tutorials. And so the video that I published that was the Handsy Top, the free seamwork pattern, three different ways, is the best performing video I've done so far, and so I'm thinking a lot of people are looking into getting into sewing, which can be somewhat opaque and difficult to get into without video help. So not just explaining the techniques to you, but showing them to you. And sewing is especially an expensive hobby, getting started, especially when you have to buy a machine and then all the tools and the notions. So I think that people are looking for a lot of free beginner patterns and patterns that they can start with. And so yeah, those are my best performing videos. So those are all the questions I'll answer today. I hope this video isn't too long. I'll try and edit it down and make it succinct. Thank you for sending me your questions if you did, and I hope that I got to all of them. I know some of you asked to see my sewing space, and I will show you that in a future video, I promise. And then some of you also asked about recommendations for beginner sewing patterns, and I have a whole video that I'm going to be making about that. So stay tuned. Don't hesitate to like and subscribe so that you don't miss any new videos. And then if I didn't get to your question, don't hesitate to leave it in the comments below. I hope that you are all doing well, that you are creatively inspired, and I will see you here again soon with another video. Bye-bye.